Friendship of Awful Gaming Experience. This is your host, Manuel Kern. And we're going to continue our Let's Play and Explore Torment Tides of Numenera Early Access version. Just talked to the Master Foreman, who has told us many fascinating things about this place and the cartographers, which are the creators of this world somehow, and yeah, we're now going to continue this underground factory. Energies from this massive engine are channeled into metal pipes set below ground and distributed throughout Underbelly. And here is the one without legs and someone named Tarnish. Let's talk to Tarnish first. The elderly man stares vacantly at a distant wall, muttering under his breath. His hands flex on the air, twisting and tweaking as if he's repairing a machine only he can see. He jumps when you draw in a breath to speak. Yes, what, he says. His eyes rove past you, halt, then return to focus on your face with some effort. And you, a quiet one, he says cheerfully. We should hang chimes from your ears to keep you from surprising people. What do you need? What do you do here? I take care of my master, he says simply, the underforeman. There used to be more of us when he was making things, but when he lost interest, that one, he jerks the yellowed thumb at the master foreman. Hire them all, offer them more. Tarnish spits on the ground. Happened a while back, but I don't forget a slight. Scan thoughts. He's a good foreman, maybe the best. If he didn't have this fool idea in his head. How long have you worked with a foreman? Couldn't say, he says. His brow furrows. On my first day, I'd already met my wife, but she was still married to, what's his name, the fish hook tattoo, and I hadn't lost a finger and grown it back yet, so he peers at the ceiling mouth working. 70 years, give or take, I should retire, but there'd be no one left to mind him if I left. Scan thoughts, what would I do with myself anyway? Why do you keep calling your master he? It's a robot. I've worked for him a long time. Guess I stopped seeing him as a thing, and more like a him. Tarnish shrugs. All of us have our little ways, even him. Thank you and goodbye. This is where we can go up to the Order of Truth. See that? And now let's talk to the underforeman. The foreman without legs. Crippled foreman. Segments of this bisected construct's legs lie scattered around it. Someone has painstakingly altered these pieces, giving them small limbs and tiny metallic heads. Nonetheless, they aren't moving. The larger construct's turquoise eyes flicker out of sync with each other as they turn towards you. As with the other construct, you feel the bubbling sensation in your mind. This construct's thoughts are likewise unreadable. I do not understand, it says. The voice emerging from the grill around its eyes is soft, as though you are hearing it from far away. Don't they want to live? The viaducts are open. The commands are received, and yet its eyelids flutter. Every time I give my children life, they die. These tiny things are your children. Not anymore, it says. Now they are inanimate and lifeless. Their adaptive personalities have been lost. I do not understand why they are dying. I have given the subject of procreation a great deal of thought over the last century, and there are no errors in my calculations. My assistant, Tarnish, built my children's bodies to my precise specifications. Their intelligence reservoirs are shielded against permanent loss. Its eyes turn away from yours, as if it is embarrassed. And I want them to live. That should be enough. Let me examine them. I might be able to help you. It does not protest, so you examine the motionless constructs on the ground in front of the foreman. What you can understand of the technology here, the foreman is correct. These little constructs should be working, but they aren't. May be possible that the flaw is not in them. You share this information with the foreman. I agree, it says, and I believe a new direction has presented itself. My children need more energy to live, but my construction prevents me from transfers above a certain threshold, and for good reason. Its pupils rotate, contracting. Energy transfers above a certain percentage would lead to a chain of ruptures in my intelligence rings. I would die, its voice mesh clicks. Help me force myself to make this transfer, for I cannot do it myself. Click. Help me give life to my children. What it asks sounds difficult, Callistique murmurs, tapping her chin. Difficult, but not impossible. The Order of Truth may be able to help us accomplish what it wants. Will you help me? The foreman says. The words are almost buried beneath a crackling surge of static. This is an interesting experiment for an intellectual like us. I want to help you. How do I begin? Speak to Tarnish, my assistant. He may be able to help you understand how I function if he is feeling well enough. But first I've got some questions. Can I examine you? Yes, it says. Tarnish, open my preservation hatches and viaduct shields, please. The elderly workman shuffles over and does as he's asked. Oh my, Callistique says beside you, I don't claim to understand everything I'm seeing here, but you'll need an extra set of hands if you're planning to do what the poor creature wants. She smiles. I have hands to spare, of course. You've never seen technology like this, said the crippled foreman. Wires pass through glass tubes, threaded with pale light and star-speckled darkness. You glance over at Tarnish. He's looking away, arms crossed, as though unwilling to watch a stranger tinker with his master. The tubes themselves have an oddly organic configuration that curve through several mysterious brushed cases. From what you can see, the foreman's trouble is not due to his physical body. Something must be wrong with the intelligence itself, the foreman's mind. The vision falls on you like a wave swallowing a swimmer. You approach this foreman, still possessed of his legs, its legs, and open the same hatches that Tarnish did. I know it looks complex, the foreman says, but the viaducts are the simplest part. The machine spirit, me, that is trickier. Even I don't fully understand it. It loves me. The vision fades, leaving you standing before the ruins of that once cheerful construct again. Could use a tidal surge. Could attempt to bypass the foreman's mind and pass its life to its children just like that. But we want to know more first. Why do you want children? Need, the construct says, not want. Its pupils study the distant ceiling. When I was born, I began working in seconds. I did this until our creators shut down our bodies. In the millennia since, I have focused on designing the infrastructure beneath the other foreman's work and instructing workers on how to execute on these designs. Pupils fall back to you. Eventually, I realized I was unhappy. From time to time, my workers brought their children to the manufactory, holding their small hands, explaining the mysteries of this place to them. His pupils flicker off. It began as a thought. What would I teach my own children? To be curious, to explore, to ask foolish questions, to see the world above that we three have never seen. The foreman's pupils reappear, and when I thought these things, I saw the shape of my children, outlined by daylight. They already existed. You seem very dispassionate about your failures to create children. I have been through 27 iterations of birth, with each attempt more of my non-essential personality and intelligence rings rupture. The foreman's eyes dim. Know that these small bodies are only bodies. 27 versions of my children have lived and died within them. know that they lived long enough for me to understand their personalities and name them before they were purged. Lost, a soft whirring issues from the mesh around the foreman's flickering eyes. Can you tell me about how you and the other foreman came to be like this? I will not, the foreman says calmly. It is not an era I wish to revisit. Speak with the master foreman instead. Why don't you want to talk about your past? Because the master foreman revels in the past and will be happy to share it with you. I do not and would not. All right, thank you and goodbye. And we'll go up there and see if we can find out something at the Order of Truth. A set of floating rungs rises from the floor, leading up to a more conventional ladder built into the side of the ancient ship. The ladder disappears into darkness above. Climb up. And again we see Divitiaku, the founder of the Order of Truth, and the strange door to the Order of Truth. Oh, let's go in there. Anyone new standing here? No? We need to talk to them first before we do anything foolish here. Now, who would be able to help us? Probably Len Uring, with all his knowledge about AI. So let's talk to him first. Alright, nothing new for him, Salimeri. This guy is also a good bet, but let's just see. Nope. And Min? Do you have more time to talk about mechanical Numenera? The responsible answer is no, but no one needs me to sign anything right now, so yes, I do. One of the foremen is trying to create offspring, and I was told the Order of Truth could help. Not the master foreman, I hope, Min says with a disbelieving laugh. One of him. It is more than enough. This sounds like something that would interest Snurf quite a bit, he says. And when you head back to the underbelly, tell Master Artisan I said hello. Thank you and goodbye. Before we talk to Snurf, of course he was the obvious, let's talk to Beliazar for a short second. Maybe he knows something new as well. Nope. Let's go back to Snurf and his procreation study. Of course, it was so logical. Snuff? Yes. The visitant's mechanical fingers race over the device before it, bending at bone-breaking angles to adjust and tweak the parts within. Welcome back, fellow sentient. May I assist you with something? One of the foremen is trying to transfer energy into its children, but they keep dying. Do you think you can help? Absolutely, the visitant says, then pauses. I must regretfully ask for the small payment of 75 shins to cover my expenses. However, I am a guest here and not an Aeon priest. The city does not fund my research. Yeah, well, here's the money. Excellent, the visitant says. Now let me ask you a few questions about the situations. Do try to be accurate or the device I craft will be less effective. First of all, as you know, this is an unusual case. Machine intelligences are rarely driven to create offspring. Why does the foreman wish to have children? Believes that the children already exist and are waiting to be born. Ah, predestined existence, it says, recording your answer. An uncommon philosophy, but not unheard of. It also raises interesting questions about the reason for the intelligences infertility. Why can't it create offspring if it so obviously wants them? On to the second question. The Wizenton says, has it had any success in transferring its energy to its children? How long does it take the children to expire? Almost immediately. Intriguing, it says, taking another note. Final question. How are the Foreman's intelligences stored? Void arrays, shielded ring coils, or some other method? I think some other method. The Foremen are extremely old. Ah, yes, the blessing and the curse of the Numenera. Snurfs are so unique and therefore so incredibly difficult to study properly, to classify them as they deserve. It makes a final note. I shall do my best regardless. At any rate, I shall get to work. This should not take long. Here you are, Snurf says, laying a heavy cylinder on the table with a magnetic clink. In short, there is nothing wrong with the Foreman's body, and it wants to have children. Therefore, something in the intelligence's governing spirit, the sub-intelligence, if you will, must be blocking the energy transfer. The visitant pats the cylinder. Attaching this device to the Foreman should disable the sub-intelligence's defenses. Good luck. Well, goodbye. But it was talking about the rings, right? Do we have made a mistake? We'll see. I think we only have one try. We'll just ask him again. Excuse the noise, but I'm eating some carrots while doing this. Why carrots, you ask? Well, carrots are perfectly fine food, as you may know from some games as well. And don't starve, you can eat carrots to survive just fine. Let's climb down. I'm not a rabbit, though, if you may have suspected this. And now let's go back to the underbelly. And check on the Foreman again, and then go forward with this procreation. Hello there. Crippled Foreman. The Foreman's flickering eyes focus on you as you approach, and an intermittent buzzing fills the air. You feel the air thicken and segment around you as though invisible fingers are prodding at your belongings. You have brought a device from the Order of Truth, the Foreman says at last. What is its purpose? It should be a bypass the part of you that is preventing you from creating offspring. Very well. Construct says, I am ready. Can I examine you again? Certainly, says Tarnish. Open the hatches and shields again, please. Why do you want children again? All right, we'll try to use the method in the procreative search turbine to transfer the Foreman's life to its children. Success. The turbine hums into life. The fans within whirl, singing a high trembling note, and cold energy pours through the air like blood from a wound, flooding into the motionless children. One by one, their tiny eyes flicker into life. One by one, the Foreman's eyes go out, its voice mesh rattles as if it's going to speak. Crippled foreman, go, the construct croaks. Explore! Probably live, and it falls silent. The children watch the death of their parent with wide, glowing eyes. He would want me to thank you, the old man says hoarsely, but I ain't. You knew him all of 10 minutes. Known him my entire life, I have, and you came and took him from me. Without a look at his master's children, Tarnish sets off into the dark. Some of the little constructs wander in circles, chirping to themselves. One of them is already making for the exit, and one is motionless, stillborn. You'll take the dead one to examine it and let the others go free. You carefully pick up the stillborn construct, cradling it. The rest of the foreman's children chase each other for a few moments longer before following the one heading for the exit. Ah, how lovely. I do hope no one steps on them, Calisthenic says. What do the others have to say about that? Probably nothing. Let's check. Oh, it's you, it growls. The human that helped the underforeman abandon its post, says the master foreman. Little loss, I'd say. Not much impact on the schedule, but try not to kill any more of us. Goodbye. So, what about the artisan foreman? Ah, hello, the construct says. This is difficult to say, but thank you for helping underforeman. I would have done the same if I could. What can I do for you? Well, Min of Tang Liang from the Order of Truth says hello. Really, tell him he should visit more often, the construct pauses, if he doesn't like the smell. The foreman's worker chuckles. Goodbye, artisan. Go enjoy the sunlight for me, he says. Let's see what else we can do here. The manufactory. There's a pauper here, and there is someone named McKellar. And this giant pillar. Oh, we can access the strange pillar. Maybe we should do that in the next episode, because this has been going on quite long, so let's go out of here with this majestic view on the giant eye-bobbing pillar. Thank you for watching. Please come again and watch the next episode when we explore this giant pillar and the rest of the underbelly. All of the rest, but still, happy gaming to you. See you in the next episode. This is Immanuel Kant signing out.